Good morning, everybody. Could you all stand and join in with us for prayer and praise and worship? For this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Come on, let us put our hands together and just give the Lord a hand clap of praise and just begin to worship him and give his name honor and glory just for allowing us to be here this Sunday. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Can we bow our heads? Heavenly Father, God, we come to you this morning, God, just to say thank you. God, we thank you for the blessings of this day, God. We thank you for life, health, and strength, God. We thank you for brand new mercies, God. God, we thank you for just being God and God all by yourself. God, we thank you for allowing us just to be in this place, God, to take of your broken body and your shed blood, God, on this 12th time in 2019. God, we know that many started out with us, God, but we thank you, God, that you allowed us to still be here, God. God, we come praying for your anointing, God, a supernatural anointing, God, just to touch us in this place, God. God, we pray for blessings, God. We pray for breakthroughs, God. We pray for strongholds to be broken right now in the name of Jesus, God. God, we ask that you touch every person who will come through that door, God. Whatever the need is in their life, God, we ask that you meet it. God, we thank you. God, we praise you. We give your name all the glory and the praise. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Come on, put your hands together.
What can I say about your mercy? What can I say about your grace? All that I know is that you've been faithful. All that I know is I love to call your name. If I say you're good, you've been
better than that.
If I say you're great, you've been
richer than that.
If I say you're strong, you've been
stronger than that.
If I say you're holy, you're
more than that.
You've been
more and more in my life.
Do-do-do-do-do. Come on, come on.
Do-do-do-do-do-do.
He'll make you want to say.
Can I say
about your mercy?
Oh, oh.
What can I say?
What can I say
about your grace?
Yeah.
All that I know is that you've been faithful. One thing for sure is I love to call your name. If I say you're good, you've been
better than that.
If I say you're great, you've been
greater than that.
He'll make you wanna say, makes me wanna say, come on, y'all know this. If I say you're good, you've been
better than that.
If I say you're great, you've been
greater than that.
If I say you're sweet, you've been
sweeter than that.
You've been
more and more in my life.
say you're strong, you've been
stronger than that.
If I say you're holy, you are
more than that.
You've been
more and more in my life.
Can you say it again now?
More and more in my life.
Say it again.
More and more in my life.
Somebody shout hallelujah right now. Give him praise. Give him glory. Give him honor in this place. Everybody,
hey.
Everybody,
hey.
Somebody say,
uh-huh.
I know you've been good, but you've been
better than that.
Oh, yeah, I know you've been good, but you've been
better than that.
Oh, yeah, I know you've been good, but you've been
better than that.
Amen. Won't you give God some praise, my brothers and sisters? This is the day the Lord has made. Won't you remain standing? Today is World AIDS Day, and we share in that time of celebration, remembering our brothers and our sisters who not only have passed, but those who are still infected and affected by that dreaded disease. And so we're going to have persons who work very hard in the community sharing in our acts of worship, and someone's going to come now and share in our call to worship, and then someone's going to read our scripture at the appropriate time. Come on, let's praise God for them as they come.
Someone is coming. Someone is coming to grant dignity to long-suffering bodies. Someone is coming to the breathless. Someone is coming to those who lack energy. Someone is coming to those who grow thinner every day. Someone is coming to those who don't know if their hands will work tomorrow. Someone is coming to those who have neither mother nor father. Someone is coming to those who cannot get their medicine. Someone is coming to those who have cares, who puts their care into action. All together, we are waiting.
We ask that you remain standing and join in with us for our hymn of the morning, Jesus, the Light of the World. Shine bright, shine all around us.
Amen, amen. Good morning. To God be the glory. You will say in that day, I will give thanks to you, O Lord, for though you were angry with me, your anger turned away and you comforted me.
Surely God is my salvation. I will trust in you and not be afraid, for the Lord God is my strength and my might. He has become my salvation.
With joy, you will draw water from the wells of salvation. Amen. Sing praises to the Lord, for he has done gloriously. Let this be known in all the earth. All together, shout aloud, sing for joy, O royal Zion, for great in your midst is the Holy One of Israel. Amen.
Brother Hank can read that. All right, come on, let's put our hands together and praise God. He didn't want to say anything. My brothers and sisters, as you know, today is the first Sunday in the season of Advent. Today, we're going to do something for this entire season. The next four Sundays, we're doing something radically different, where we're going to have four of our members who live away, who are virtual members, as I call them today. Sister Melanie Bethel, all the way from New York, where it's snowing, is going to lead us in our Advent liturgy. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God for her as she comes.
The Advent season is a time when we reflect on the second coming of Jesus Christ. The theme for this first Sunday of Advent is hope. The scripture reminds us that Jesus will return. We live in hope, in expectation of the fulfillment of this truth, and we prepare for Jesus' return. Though living in hope will not guarantee a life devoid of challenge and disappointment, we have the assurance that when gripped by despair, we can trust in God. We will light a candle today, believing in the promise of a secure and eternal future with Jesus Christ, a time when wolves and lambs will live in peace together. Living in hope is an investment.
Amen. Reverend Andrea, if you can light the purple candle, let's stand as we continue in our reading of our light of Advent liturgy. We light this candle, believing in the promise of a secure and eternal future. Go back. We light this candle, believing in the promise of a secure and eternal future with Jesus Christ. Come, let us walk in the light of the Lord. And repent, for the kingdom of heaven is near. Let us walk in the light of the Lord. Amen. Oh God of hope, we praise you, for your alone do wondrous things. Give us strength to live through these present days as we prepare for the unexpected hour when Jesus returns. We pray in faith that every day our lives will overflow with hope in you. We pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns forever and ever. Amen. Come on, let's put our hands together. Praise God. Thank you so much. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. My brothers and sisters, it is so good to see each and every one of you, those who worship in virtually. Come on, anybody else just glad to be alive and alive in Christ Jesus? Come on, put your hands together. Give God some praise. My brothers and sisters, let me thank you for your kindness, for your generosity last week. Let me thank those who served. Last week we shared in providing over 85 Thanksgiving baskets, including turkeys for needless families. Come on, let's put our hands together. and give God some praise. I thank you and I praise you. Next week, my brothers and sisters, we'll have our list. So let's start preparing for our Christmas LOL, where on December the 25th at 7 a.m. we'll meet here at the church, and we'll provide opportunities to be a blessing, to remind ourselves that Jesus was homeless. The Bible tells us that foxes had holes and birds had nests, but the Son of Man had no place to lay his head. So we're going to go find our homeless brothers on Christmas morning and sisters, and we're going to take them gifts. We're going to come bearing gifts. Don't forget about all the announcements of the day and of the week. They're scrolling on the screens. Let me thank you, my brothers and my sisters, for preparing for our church conference vision night tomorrow night at 7 p.m. joining us on the prayer line. Our new devotionals are here. Please pick some up before you go. For those who are worshiping virtually, if you would email the church, we'll be glad to sign you up to receive those daily devotions every morning at 5:30 in the morning. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God for that opportunity to minister. Announcements are at the bottom of those daily devotionals. The announcements are at the bottom of those daily devotionals. Sister Tammy, the announcements at the bottom of those daily devotionals. Turn to your neighbor and say, neighbor, Sister Tammy not the only one not reading the announcements. Somebody ought to say amen. Turn to another neighbor on the other side and say, neighbor, you too, read the announcements at the bottom of the devotionals. We are grateful. Those who want to go to Belize spring break with us, please do so. In March, and those who are willing to want to go to the Holy Land with us, those opportunities are available. I broke it down for someone the other day. About $390 a month will get you to the Holy Land in November, including your flight, your hotel, two meals a day, transportation, and just be able to walk on the steps where Jesus walked. So I would love for you to join us, because next year, this time, we'll be in the Holy Land. Somebody ought to say amen. And so I would love for you to join us in that time. My brothers and my sisters, please don't forget about all the announcements of the day and of the week, and make yourself available to take an active part in the life and the ministry of the IT. Let me ask, do we have any first-time guests in the house? I promise I won't have you to say anything, but we want to just praise God for you being in the house. Any first-time guests in the house, won't you stand? Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God. I want to thank you for coming and sharing. We know you could have gone to a lot of churches this morning, but we praise God that God has divinely orchestrated our paths across. It is my prayer that a song that was sung, a prayer that was prayed, and when the word of God is proclaimed, it will move on the altars of your heart to encourage you. Everything in that gift bag is yours. You want to find out more about our church, go to our website, theit.org, or even our Facebook and social media pages, The Emmanuel Temple. We've got some other guests. Some of our virtual members from Tallahassee slipped in town, Brother Reggie and Sister June. Come on, let's praise God for all of our guests. Come on, let the church shout, welcome. All right, everybody standing on your feet. Find somebody you didn't speak to. Hug them real tight. Everybody standing on your feet. Find somebody you didn't speak to. Hug them real tight. Look them in the eye and tell them God loves you. And so do I. And there's nothing you can do about it.
Brothers and sisters, I want to welcome you back to life. Back to the one that can make your next chapter your best chapter. Hallelujah.
How can it be that you love the most unlovable part of me? Of me. How did you see? Your life was the only gift I left for me. Hey!
Amen. Where is Sister Angie? Where is Sister Angie? Oh, okay. All right. Then praise the Lord. All right. My brothers and sisters, don't forget about the other announcements. Persons signing up for our LOL ministries. We'll talk about that more tomorrow night during our vision night. Again, everyone is invited. My brothers and sisters, I'm going, the old church would have a time of testimony. Somebody ought to say amen. The people in the country would say giving your determination. I'm always blessed by, the Bible says that we are blessed by the testimony of others. I just heard this testimony. I think you all will be blessed too. So I'm going to ask Sister Angie to come, one of our faithful servants here. And she's going to share her testimony. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God for her witness.
Good morning, everybody. I slipped this morning. But anyway, my testimony is, for those who don't know, I've been trying to get a house for the last 2 years, to buy my own house the last 2 years. And I was denied because of my income. This year, I was pre-approved. Y'all didn't hear me. I was pre-approved with the same salary that the other people denied me on. But there's more to that blessing. I'm also approved for 5 grants that I don't have to pay back. So I was qualified for a $200,000 house, which the bank, I would only have to pay the bank $65,000. When I tell you God worked that thing out for me, he worked it out. And on top of that, you're looking at I've been denied of a promotion at my job because I'm wasn't that good on the computer for supervisor. You're now looking at the senior mechanic. I've been promoted to senior mechanic. And I just want to tell all of you, just because man say no, just because man say no, you keep the faith because God said yes. Don't stop coming to church. Don't stop serving. Don't stop paying your tithe. That's very important. The enemy will try to get you to steal from God, but the devil is a liar. So you're looking at a miracle right here today. So whatever you seeking God for, believe and trust that he'll make it a way for you. And my next blessings, I'm going to keep it to myself until it's time to get it. Because I hadn't planned on doing this here, but you know your pastor. But anyway, keep the faith. Know that God is able to do all things but fail. Just look to the hill.
Somebody who didn't want to say nothing, Joe had a whole lot to say. What an awesome testimony. Can we put our hands together and praise God for Sister Angie? We met her 11 years ago this time, and matter of 11 years ago this week, and had a flip phone. didn't know that Reverend Maria was prophesying over her life to tell her that she was going to be in charge of the computers for the women's ministry. And now, because the God will pour it into her, she now has a promotion using the computer when she didn't even want to use the computer 11 years ago. You can't make me doubt him because I know too much about him. My brothers and sisters, what an awesome intro for our time of giving our tithes and our offerings. I'm simply going to ask you to trust God. Those who have not started to become a recurring giver, which simply means every time you get paid, you give back to the Lord. I want to challenge you to become one today. Sister Angie is a faithful tither, and she shared that. And I'm convinced, my brothers and my sisters, the Bible is right. If you give, the Lord will give back to you. Full measure, pressed down, shaken together, run of over. She said, don't steal from God. The Bible says when we don't give our tithes, we rob God. Brother Justin, Brother Cook, Brother Willard, there's robberies every Sunday all over the world. People in church robbing God of what is due to God. And so whatever you're going to give today, as you know, there's several ways you can give on our website, theit.org, on our app, The Emmanuel Temple, on our website, theit.org, Cash App, $, The Emmanuel Temple. Whatever you're going to give today, come on, let's put it in our right hand. Let's lift it up to the Lord. You know what I'm going to say? If the day is not your day, praise God that Friday is coming. Let's pray. Our Lord and our God, today we repent for the times we've stolen from you to do things we wanted to do, but was not things that we needed to do. So God, we thank you, God. Even when we were stealing from you, you were still finding ways to bless us. And so, God, we ask that you would restore unto us the joy of our salvation. God, that we may have smiles on our faces when we give back to you, God, because you've given so much to us. God, you opened so many doors. You've made so many ways for us. And so, God, we give back to you, God, because you've given first and you gave your best gift, and that was your Son, Jesus the Christ. And so, God, take these, our gifts, the tithes and offerings, press them down, shake them together, and run them over so that your kingdom may come here on earth as it is in heaven. In the name of Jesus the Christ, we pray. And all those who love the Lord said amen. And we know that God loves a... God loves a. Won't y'all do me a favor? Everybody, if you can just pass your tithes and offering, those who are using envelopes, to the center. Brother Walker's going to walk through the center of the aisle and pick those up as we praise God for an opportunity to give. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God. My brothers and sisters, there are several persons we want to continue to keep lifted in prayer. Sister Patricia Moore had an accident, broke some toes in Stark, Florida. She's on her way back home. She's asking the church to keep her lifted in prayer. My brothers and sisters, it's good to see the Miller family back in worship. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God for them. We want to continue to pray for our members who are on our prayer wall, those who are worshiping digitally. If you have some prayer requests, please send those in. We're also praying for our members who are fighting cancer. It's good to see the Butler family back in worship. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God for them. I ask that you would continue to keep them lifted in prayer. It's good to see several of our members who've lost loved ones back in worship. Come on, let's get praise God. Sister Zebedisha, it's good to see her. My brothers and sisters, we have members who are still out of work for several months, but they don't know how much they are blessing me. because we have not heard them complain yet. We ask that you would keep them lifted in prayer. We're also praying for our members who are dealing with crisis, whatever that crisis may be. They need our prayers. We also want to continue to keep praying for those who worship virtually each and every Sunday. We want to want you to know that your church is praying for you, and we have you on our mind, and we're going to take the time out to pray for you. There may be others that I'm not aware of, sick, grieving losses of loved ones. Keep my mother lifted in prayer. She funeralized her sister-in-law on Friday in South Carolina. So I want you to continue to keep our family lifted in prayer. Right where you are, I want you to whisper a word of prayer. I pray for our brothers and sisters in Haiti. Things have taken a turn. Persons have been able to travel back to Haiti again. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God for their witness. Right where you are, I want you to whisper a word of prayer.
But you did it, you made a way. Standing here, not knowing how we'll get through this test, but holding on to faith you know best. Nothing can catch you by surprise. You've got this figured out. And you're watching us now. But when it looks as if you can't win, you wrapped us in your arms and stepped in. Everything we need you to supply. You got this in control. And now we know that you
get up on your feet if you know we made a way. Come on, come on.
'Cause you move mountains, you cause walls to fall with your power. Perform miracles. There is nothing that's impossible. And we're standing here only because you made a way.
Come on, sing it. You cause
walls to fall
with your power.
Perform miracles. I'm talking to myself. That's impossible.
That's impossible.
And we're standing here. Come on. Cause you move
mountains.
You cause war. Y'all know it. You made it.
You made it.
Don't know how.
Don't know how, but you did.
Come on. Don't know how.
Don't know how, but you did.
Hey. You did it.
Don't
know how, but you did it.
Don't know why.
Come on.
Why
you save me?
Why
you keep me?
Why
you so good to me? Come on. Over and over and over. You move a mountain. Cause you move a mountain. Cause you move mountains. Cause you move a mountain. And you cause walls to fall. 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 And you cause chains to break. 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 Cause you move mountains. Come on, how many of you know it? Cause you move mountains. Come on, come on, cause you move mountains. Cause you move mountains. Mountains are moving. Mountains are moving. Mountains are moving. Mountains are moving. Strongholds are breaking now. Strongholds are breaking. Strongholds are breaking. Strongholds are breaking. Cause you move mountains. Come on, y'all know it. Cause you move mountains. And everything that you did for me. Cause you move mountains. Cause you move mountains. Breathing, I am still 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 breathing.
the doctor said no, you said yes. When the doctor said no, you said yes. When they pronounced me dead, you said not yet. When they called me dead, you said not yet. Could you move mountains? Come on. Could you move mountains? Could you move mountains? Could you move mountains?
And I'm standing here only because you made a way. And I'm standing here only because you made a way. And I'm standing here only because you made. After you've done all you can, after you've done all you can, after you've done all you can, oh, after you've done all you can, hey, after you've done all you can, you just stand.
Come on, won't you reach your right hand up to this altar as we go to God in prayer. God, I thank you for reminding us that your word says we fall down 7 times, but we get back up again. Thank you, God, for reminding us that when the world throws us away, you're not the God of a second chance, but you're the God of another chance. Thank you, God, for reminding us that you still move mountains, cause walls to fall. So, God, Willard here today, God, but it could be one of us tomorrow. It's the Miller family. It's the Miller's family time now, God, but could it be, it could be ours, not tomorrow, but later on today. And so, God, you called us to be the church, to weep with those who weep and mourn with those who mourn. And so, God, we lift the Miller family up to you, but we also lift up the Butler family. God, as they go through their own time of crisis right now. But God, remind not only them, but those who are here under the sound of my voice and those who are worshiping virtually that we are built for this. We're built to last, God, that we're not going to crumble or shrink under pressure, God, because we are reminded that you are Emmanuel, God is with us. And so, God, strengthen us in the midst of our struggles, God. Remind us that you still have your hands on us, God. Remind us that you have not brought us this far to leave us. Remind us, God, that you still have much work for us to do. And So God, hear the prayers of your sons and your daughters, God, sitting in this sanctuary, worshiping virtually. Hear the prayers, God, of those, God, who are not sitting in this sanctuary, God, but who are standing in need of prayer, who are connected to those who are worshiping virtually or sitting in this sanctuary. Now, God, as we move to this preaching moment, hide us once again behind the cross and under the drippings of your blood. Give me a new, fresh anointing. Have me not to rely on the early service anointing, but give me a new, fresh anointing that yokes would be destroyed and burdens would be lifted and strongholds would be torn down, that someone won't leave like they came. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, if you still know he moves mountains, come on, put those glad hands together. Give God some praise. My brothers and sisters, won't you stand on your feet for the reading of God's word found in the book of Matthew, chapter 1. I'm going to read several passages of scripture in your hearing, verses 1, 2, 3, jump down to 5 and 6, and then jump down to 16 and 17 on this first Sunday of Advent. Listen, and I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version. Listen to the word from the Lord. On an account of the genealogy of Jesus, the Messiah, the son of David, the son of Abraham. Abraham was the father of Isaac, and Isaac the father of Jacob, and Jacob the father of Judah and his brothers. And Judah the father of Perez and Zerah by Tamar, and Perez the father of Hezron, and Hezron the father of Aram. And Solomon the father of Boaz by Rahab, and Boaz the father of Obed by Ruth, and Obed the father of Jesse, and Jesse the father of King David, and David was the father of Solomon by the wife of Uriah. Verse 16, and Jacob the father of Joseph, the husband of Mary, and of whom Jesus was born, who is called the Messiah. So all the generations from Abraham to David are 14 generations, and from David to the deportation to Babylon, 14 generations. From the deportation to Babylon to the Messiah, 14 generations. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. I want to put a tag on this text for our preaching this morning, Reality TV. I want you to turn to your neighbor real quick and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, Reality TV. My beloved in the Lord, I wonder if I set a camera up at your Thanksgiving gathering on last Thursday, what would the world see? Beyond the food and the laughs, the outfits, the spades games, and for the old folks, big whists, the libations and red cups, the loud kids playing and the fellowship, what about the conversations that were murmured under breaths about the latest family drama that is getting played out, but no one wants to acknowledge it? Besides the questions of who cooked what and what time are we eating, what about the other conversations that were in each corner of the house by particular family members? Can I just share what was talked about in our family's Thanksgivings this past Thursday? The cousins who are on the run because they are still selling crack or on crack. The siblings who have children they don't take care of. The uncles who still act like they are 65 and who still act like they are 25 and they are 65. Aunts who wear clothes that don't fit and other family members who act like they ain't got no sense. The brothers who were just bailed out of jail, the nieces who flunked out of college, and the others who got pregnant in high school, and the cousins who say they are kin to us, but we don't know how, but has a hookup on all of the stuff for the low, which still has tags on them, and they didn't even go to the mall on Black Friday. The old cousins who know better but don't do better and change booze like clothes and don't take care of their own kids and still stay at home with their mama broke but club every weekend and do it big for the gram with bad weaves and wigs. The uncles who are petty, trifling with their finances, ratchet with what comes out of their mouths and still think they are bad and bougie. The aunties who talk about everybody else and how bad they are doing, but never mention how ratchet their stuff really is. Who talk a big game but never back it up with their actions, who always want to take several plates home after dinner is over but never stay around to clean up, to cook after everyone has eaten, and who can tell you what not to do but they go do the very same things themselves. The sisters who never let us forget what they've done for us, always reminding us of what we did wrong and who think their stuff really doesn't stink. The brothers who love to tell us about what they have and where they have been, but don't mention the fact that they lied and schemed to get there. They use someone else's credit cards for the trips and have two different social security numbers. We might not want to admit it, but some of us have been shocked by what we found out about our uncles who had children we knew nothing about, and our aunts who were pregnant before they got married but had some procedures done. The uncles that love to remind us what they used to do, who are really cray-cray, love to act the fool and are loud and ignorant and rude, and from time to time cross the criminal line. They don't care about anybody else's feelings and stay up in all up in our feelings all of the time. The little cousins who would rather smoke weed and drink alcohol than eat healthy and watch television or scroll on social media rather than read the Bible. Maybe there's somebody else in the house and worshiping virtually who knows I was at your house on Thursday, huh? And if I was, then go ahead and just shout, show you right. Matthew's gospel doesn't start with the events of the manger, stars, and shepherds. Matthew always wants to connect us with our Jewish heritage, so he gives us a long, tedious genealogy. As much as I've read this passage, Reverend James, I've often skipped these verses because I lost patience with them to get to the story, but someone in the house like me has missed some things, and I want to pull out my holy highlighter to show us what we've missed this morning. Matthew is writing and living in a time with a very family-oriented communal society. In those times, it was the pedigree, the family name and clan, the people who you were connected to that made you who you were. So the genealogy was a way of saying to the world, this is my social media page. You remember, Bible readers, that King Herod the Great purged many names from his public genealogy because he didn't want anyone to know they were connected to him. The purpose of a genealogy was to impress onlookers with high quality and the respectability of one's roots. Keep your phone out and the Bible app open because we'll see how Matthew continues with a long list of intentional names. Matthew lifts up specific people in our text intentionally for a reason. And that's a word for someone in the house this morning. Everything God does it intentionally. God has Matthew select these names that I've read for a reason, and I just want to remind someone that God is sovereign. And Brother Miller, that simply means that God is in control. One author says God loves us so much that God joins us in our circumstances and puts God's arms around us and strengthens us and assures us of working this into his incredible plan. God joins us in our brokenness and even our mistakes. God joins in our could've, should've, would've's. God joins us in our missteps and our dumb decisions, our poor choices, our errors, and our ways. God joins us and works out his redemptive love purposes even in our sins and our messes. And he works through all of it, through the bad, the ugly, the ruthless, the wicked, the dangerous, the unhealthy, the regretful, the remorseful, the contrite, the guilty, the awful, the shocking, the dreadful, the terrible, and the horrific things that we've done and have been done to us, from A to Z, from Alpha to Omega. God has been working through it all to get us to the place where we are right now. And I just need someone else in the house or who is worshiping virtually besides me that's glad that we have a God like that, who is working through everything we've done and not done, said and not said. God is working through our shortcomings, our sicknesses, our sadness, our fears, our foolishness, our fears, our doubts, our divorces, our diseases, our debt, our loneliness, our lumps on our breasts, and our losses. God is working through all of it every single thing, every incident, every detail of our lives to mold us and shape us into the people who he's destined us to be. And I believe I have some folks in the house and who's worshiping virtually who can shout over the fact that God is working through it all. Everything, all of it, because God wastes nothing. God uses every incident, every crisis, every chaos, every situation for his glory working, because it's working for our good. Find three people and say, I don't see it right now, but God is working this for our good. Find three other people and say, I don't see it right now, but God is working for our good. Y'all looking at the wrong three people. Find three people for real and say, God is working this for our good. I don't know what this is in everyone's life right now. It could be financial challenges, relationship challenges, job situation, family problems, the health crisis. It could be the grieving of loss of a loved one. It could be loneliness. It could be health challenges. I don't know what this is, but even this, God is working it out for our good. Someone needs that word this morning. Whatever this is, God is going to use it to work it out for our good. It's no need for us to stress, get worried, cry ourselves to sleep at night, get drunk or high, eat a pint of ice cream or an entire cake, and go spend money that we don't have, or go have sex with people we don't even know, or stay up all night. Because if God never sleeps nor slumbers, if God takes care of the lilies of the field, how much more will our Heavenly Father do for those who love him? Somebody ought to shout, God is even working it out for our good. Whatever the this is. Keep your phones out. The Bible app open, because the text tells us that the promise of the Messiah took generations to fulfill. We remember, Bible readers, that Jesus was the son of Abraham, and in fact it was 400 years before Jesus was born and no prophets were sent to the people. It looked like God had forgotten about them. No one was coming, it seemed, but then Jesus showed up one day. And don't judge God by our calendar. God may appear slow, but God never forgets what God has said. My brothers and sisters, we've switched from DirecTV to Xfinity. And one of the things that I like about Xfinity Comcast, it has an Alexa type remote where you can hold the button down and speak into it and tell it what you want it to do. I knew the channels on DirecTV after being a loyal customer for over 18 years. I knew that the Word Network was 373. I knew the ESPN was 206. And during bad weather, I knew what channel the Weather Channel was, but I don't know any channels on Xfinity. But I do know how to speak, and the remote does what I tell it to do. Now, if we have a remote that can do what I tell it to do, why can't we do what God tells us to do? Even if it takes a long time, God still does what God says God's going to do. God may seem like God is working slow, even forgetting his promises, but when his promises come true, they always exceed our expectations. And I need everyone to hold your hand right up in the front of your face and speak to it and say, remember what the Lord has done for us. And it flashes up on the screen 5 years ago when your back was up against the wall and he made a way out of no way. Remember earlier this year when you didn't know how you were going to make it, and what flashes up on the screen? He still moves mountains. Remember when our loved ones died and we didn't know if we could go on? What flashes up on the screen is God wipes every tear from our eyes. Remember when our hearts were broken, and what flashes up on the screen of our lives that God was picking us up off the floor? That I'm still a heart fixer. And I believe I've got 13 people in the house and 8 more worshiping virtually who can testify like me. He made a way out of no way. Can I tell you why I shout this morning? Because even when I don't keep my promises with God, God always keeps his promises with me. I've messed up, done some wrong things, but he still kept every promise to me. Can I tell you why I shout? Because he looked beyond my faults and still sees every one of my needs. So someone else is still not convinced, so keep your phone out. Keep the Bible app open, because in verse 2 it says, Jacob was the father of Judah, who was an ancestor of the Messiah. Do we know why Judah was a child of Jacob? Jacob lied and deceived his father Isaac to get the firstborn's birthright that should have gone to his brother Esau. Because of that deception, Jacob fractured his family and turned Esau against him and had to flee the land and become a fugitive. He lost his family, experienced terrible consequences for his sin, yet it was only because of all of this that he met Leah, who became an ancestor of the Messiah. Maybe we aren't getting it. What Jacob did was wrong, and he suffered for it. But God is greater than our sin. God uses all of the sordidness, the stupidity, and the sin to bring about his promise. God uses all of our dumb decisions and financial mistakes to bring about his promise. God uses all the tales we've told, the things we've stolen, and the hearts we've hurt to bring about his promise. God uses all the stuff we've done, every single thing, to bring about his promise. We are here today because we are survivors, and I believe I have some survivors in the house and worshiping virtually because people wrote us off, tried to foreclose on our future, repossess our destiny, take our peace, snatch away our smile, steal our joy, rob us of our promise. But I believe I'm looking at some survivors and worshiping virtually. Survivors from cancer, failed businesses and relationships, survivors from broken hearts and shattered dreams, ruined reputations and crushed opportunities, survivors of incest, rape, abuse, job loss, divorce, affairs, adoption, diseases, failed tests, and kicked out of organizations. But we are still here because we are survivors. And do I have anybody that can praise God? Because they thought they had us. They thought we were down and we wouldn't get back up. They thought we were out for the count, but we got back up because we are survivors. They pushed us on the ropes, but we came out swinging. I'm looking at some survivors over here and some survivors over there and some survivors worshiping virtually. Everybody in the house who's worshiping virtually, and everybody else in the house, can just point to yourself and say, I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. I'm a survivor. This genealogy is shocking, and it's unlike any other ancient genealogy, because Reverend Maria, Matthew lists not one, not two, not three, not four, but five women in the text. May I take the time to tell you that a woman in this day was virtually never named in such a list, let alone five of them. But notice, if you will, most of the women under Jesus' family profile on Facebook were Gentiles. Tamar, Rahab, and Ruth. They were also Canaanites and Moabites. To the ancient Jews, these nations were unclean. They weren't allowed in the temple to worship. They were outsiders. Yet we see them showing up all in Jesus' family profile. By naming these particular women, Matthew deliberately recalls for the readers some of the nastiest and immoral incidents in the Bible. You remember, Bible readers, that in verse 3 it says that Judah was the father of Perez and Zerah, whose mother was Tamar. Tamar tricked her father-in-law Judah into sleeping with her, an act of incest against the law of God in this book we call the Bible. And even though Jesus descended from Perez, not Zerah, Matthew includes both of them, Judah and Tamar, to make sure that we see that the dysfunctional family that Jesus came out of. And that's a word for somebody in the house and who's worshiping virtually, who thinks that just because their family is full of dysfunctional, that God can't break generational curses that is holding us back. The devil is a lie. That's a word for someone who keeps trying to run and hide from the stuff they've done in their past. God has a word for someone who's growing up living in so many places they stop counting, that learn how to lie for their mama when the bill collectors call, and had hookup cable from their next door neighbor. God wants to heal someone this morning who has been touched inappropriately by someone in their family, and has affected their relationship with men in their life, because they can't trust. They trust the wrong people and they don't trust the right people. God wants to heal someone who's been trying to show love to people who haven't earned it or don't deserve it. Let me get to the end of the genealogy in verse 17, Matthew makes much of the numbers of the generations. There are 14 generations from Abraham to David. 14 generations from David to the exile in Babylon. And 14 generations from the exile in Babylon to Jesus. So there are 6 sevens of generations, and that makes Jesus the beginning of the seventh. And all of the Bible readers remember that seven is a highly significant number in the Bible. Seven means God, means a number of completion. And God rested from his creative work on the seventh day. And every 7 years, the farmers were to let the land replenish itself. The year of Jubilee was the 49th year, the last year of the seventh period in Leviticus. All slaves were to be freed and all debts were to be forgiven. The seventh seven was a foretaste of the final rest that we will all have when God renews the earth. So Matthew is telling us that our rest will only come through Jesus Christ. And I stop by to remind us that our salvation was accomplished through Jesus, who came from a dysfunctional family, who had kings and prostitutes, fathers of the faith who were also liars. And it doesn't matter where we've come from, who we're kin to, what we've done, who we've done it with. If we repent and believe, the grace of God can cover a multiplicity of our sin. Matthew wants to remind us that regardless of what we've done, we can still be in the family of Jesus, because it's not the good people who are in and the bad people who are out, because everyone is in only by the grace of God, because it's not about what we have done or not done, but it's what Jesus has done for us. There is no one who does not need the grace of God, and no one who can't receive the grace of God through repentance and faith in Jesus. Prostitute and king, male and female, Jew and Gentiles all sit down as equals, equally sinful and equally lost, equally accepted and equally loved by God. The grace of God is so pervasive that the genealogy is dripping with God's grace, and God is not ashamed of us because we are all his family. My brothers and sisters, in reality TV shows, there's always an end of the season episode where they bring everybody back together and they ask questions about what happened, and sometimes altercations happen, things are thrown, pause are raised, words are bleeped because children may come in the room. What we need to remember is that the producers do this because they know what's going to happen, and they want to see it happen to make sure the ratings go up. Yeah. I want us to know God knows what God is doing by choosing us to be in this life, because we belong to him, because we are sheep. We are the sheep of his pasture, and we are his children, and he is our God, and it does not yet appear what we shall be. I don't know about you, but I'm glad God chose me to be a part of his family. Even though he knew all about me, God still chose me. He picks us with all of our proclivities and our propensities. He picks us with all of our doubts and our fears. He picks us with all of our insecurities and our idiosyncrasies. God chooses us with our closed hands and minds and open mouths. God chooses us with our hard heads and hard hearts. God chooses us with our selfishness and our stinginess. God chooses us. And maybe there's somebody else this morning who is glad that God chose us. God chose us because God wanted to show the world what God can do if God could change us, if God could convert us, if God could fix us, if God could save us. What could God do to others? Anybody else glad that God changed us one day? I mean, he rearranged us one day. Anybody else glad that knows that you can sit at his feet because he changed you? Anybody else besides me knows what what they used to do and how they used to act and where they used to go and how they used to treat folks and what came out of their mouths. But one day God changed us. I may curse, but I don't curse as much as I used to. Somebody else can testify. I may drink, but I don't get drunk anymore. Somebody else knows. I may shop, but I don't shop as much as I used to. Anybody else know? They don't do what they used to do anymore, but you're not where you need to be. Because somebody needs to hear this, and I'm finished. Sanctification is a process that never ends. That's a good shouting point right there. God is constantly in the process of sanctifying us, making us more like Him. And somebody else besides me can admit, sometimes we fail. Sometimes we work against God instead of working for God. But we can shout that even when we're working against God, God never works against us. Even when we don't cooperate with God, God never takes His hands and off of us and say, I'm through with them. God, let me say it this way. God may not like the stuff we do, but God never stops loving us. Let me say it this way. We can't sin enough for God to stop loving us. We can't lie, curse, or steal enough for God to stop loving us. We can't drink, overeat, or overshop, or over anything enough for God to stop loving us. The Bible says, where can I go and flee from His presence? If I take the wings of the dove and go to the uttermost parts of the earth and the heavens, God is there. If I take my descent down into hell, God is right there. Even there, God still loves us. Turn to your neighbor real quick and say, neighbor, I don't care what you do, God still loves you. And that's a shouting point right there. Turn to the other neighbor on the other side and say, neighbor, oh neighbor, God still loves you in spite of you. Because God's love for you ain't determined by what you do or what you don't do. It's simply determined by Him coming into this world as a baby. Everybody standing on your feet. My brothers and sisters, I said in the sermon that God wastes nothing. Nothing. Somebody ought to just shout, nothing. Come on, say it like you mean it. Nothing. Come on, say it from the depths of your, from way deep down in your belly. Nothing. I don't know what you've done or not done. God wastes nothing. I don't care what has happened or what you did, God wastes nothing. All heads bowed, all eyes closed. God, we thank You that not only are You in the recycling business, but God, You don't have a landfill where You go and throw things away. Because God, You are in the process of changing us every day of our lives. Even things that we thought were so bad, You're in the process of changing us, to helping us to see that even those things You can use to work out for our good. And so, God, there may be someone in the house, there may be someone who's worshiping virtually who's not saved. It's not a member of a church. Whether they're here or worshiping virtually, God, have them to fill out the form or walk down this aisle. Come give me their hand, give you their heart, give the church their service. God, I admit to you that I want to be their pastor. I want to be the person that calls and has prayer with them, and not only are they crying, but I'm crying with them, because we mourn with those who mourn. We weep with those who weep. God, I want to be the person in their life that they're excited about sharing their testimony. They don't know that that testimony that they shared with me, how it blessed me, that I've got to push them out so they can bless someone else. God, I want to be a person in their life in mountain highs, but also in valley lows. If they're here today, God, they're worshiping virtually, have them to come, have them to fill out the form. In Jesus' name we pray. All those who love the Lord said amen. Somebody ought to come.
Has come home.
Somebody ought to come.
For me.
You're here today, not saved. Here today.
Oh,
not a member of a church. Won't you come?
Therefore, change.
Won't you come?
Has come over.
Come on, put those hands together. Somebody else ought to come. Won't you come?
Change.
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 Anybody else glad? Somebody else ought to come.
Change. I'm so glad he changed me. Change.
Somebody ought to just shout change.
Change.
Come on, say it like you mean it. Change.
Change.
I'm so glad.
Therefore, change
has
come over me.
One more time, a one.
A one.
Therefore. Put those glad hands together and give God some praise. Come on, reach your right hand up to this altar. As we go to God in prayer, God, we thank you for these, your sons and your daughters. God, you know what they are standing in need of. God, you know the kind of church that they need us to be. Help us to be the church that you called us to be, and the one they need us to be. God, we thank you for their leap of faith. We thank you, God, for uniting with this family of faith, this body of believers. We thank you, God, for these who come, for those who worship virtually, God, who this week they're going to fill out the form and unite with this family of faith, this body of believers. We thank you and we praise you, God. We ask that you would give them a Star Trek anointing, take them to places they never thought they'd go, and do with them things that they never thought they would be able to do. Cover them with your blood, God. Remind them, God, that without you they can do nothing, but with you all things are possible. In Jesus' name we pray. Come on, put those glad hands together and give God some praise. They're going to take you in the back. Going to take you in the back. Sister Ina's going to take you in the back. They're going to get some information from you. As we prepare, our usher's going to come to share. Brother David, Sister, come on back on up. Someone back on up. Yeah, come on back on up. Come on back on up. Reverend, hand me those envelopes right there. Hand me those envelopes. Thank you. Okay, all right. Gonna give you some license. All right, Reverend, thank you. Come on, y'all, you can come on up. Come on up. My brothers and sisters, as the ushers come to prepare ourselves for our gift submission, the Lord laid it on my heart what we were gonna do to give back to others for Christmas. And so, Beyonce, can you flash the LOL flyer? My brothers and sisters, I'm asking everyone to give a sacrificial gift for Christmas above and beyond your tithes and offerings. I want to be a blessing to needy kids all over the world. Kids here in South Florida and in the Central America of Belize, the only English-speaking country in Central America, our brothers and sisters in the Bahamas, and our brothers and sisters in Haiti. I want to give $4,000 in Christmas gifts to needy children all over the world. So my brothers and sisters, today I'm believing by faith that God's going to make this happen. I have for these persons help serve children whose parents have HIV and AIDS behind me. Come on, why don't you put your hands together and give God some praise. And so today I've got some gift cards of $1,000 to be a blessing to children whose parents suffer from HIV and AIDS. One of my favorite stores is the Children's Place. It's a children's store in the mall. And if you go talk to my members, they'll show you how to add coupons to these gift cards. And God can take little and make it more than $1,000. And so I'm giving these to you all to bless children. You sent me lists of infants and toddlers and children who have needs. And so I want to be a blessing. We're going to be a blessing to the tune of $1,000 to those children. Come on, let's put our hands together and praise God. Okay, so I need your help. Thank y'all so much. I need your help. We got $1,000 down. We need $3,000 to go. And so as you're passing these offering baskets, I want you to consider how much you're going to spend for Christmas and how much you're going to give to the Lord's house. All of these LOL gifts, if you need an offering envelope, raise your hand. Go to Cash App, $ The Emmanuel Temple, website, theit.org, app, The Emmanuel Temple. Put LOL Christmas there on online giving. I want us to be a blessing. I praise and thank God that our brothers and sisters in Canada are sending us $1,000 Canadian dollars for this effort, $750 US. Come on, let's put our hands together. And so that's how I got this week. I don't know what the Lord gonna do for next week, but I believe the Lord is able. Somebody ought to say amen. And so next week, we're going to share with our brothers and sisters in the Bahamas. A week from Monday, I'm going to the Bahamas. It's my prayer Wednesday. I'm going to fly to Abaco before I fly back home to see the devastation and to be a blessing to children who are still living in shelters in Nassau. And so I thank you for your gifts of tithes and offerings. I thank you for your gifts. And if you would just do me a big favor, Tuesday is Give Tuesday. You would just take that LOL flyer, share it continuously all day Tuesday with the people who in your sphere of influence that they can sow into us, that we can be an even greater witness. As our stewardesses have come now to prepare in the Lord's Supper, this is the last first Sunday of 2019, last first Sunday of a decade. And we're going to share in the Lord's Supper together. Kenya's going to sing us happy in Lord's Prayer. So I'm trying to give us some time to get ready now. I'm feeling a little churchy today. Somebody ought to say amen. So, brother Marcus, I don't know what key I'm going to be in, but you just catch me. Somebody ought to say amen. I'm down at the cross where my Savior died. Down. Okay, y'all want me to start singing? Okay, all right. Let's stand. I call to the table. It's simply this. You need to truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and in charity with your neighbor and intend to lead a new life. These preachers are going to join. Come join me. Following henceforth the commandments, draw near with faith. On this first Sunday, December, last time in this decade, I take and eat of God's broken body, broken for you and for me. I take and eat it with thanksgiving in my heart. I take and drink God's shed blood. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Take and drink with thanksgiving in my heart. Take and eat. Take and eat, Reverend. Body of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Take and drink. Blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ. Now, yes, every first Sunday we share in the general confession. But today, before we move to that, I want you to take the next 60 seconds and ponder what confessions that you need to make to God. Things you've said or not said. Things you thought that you know you should not have had those kind of thoughts. Things you've done and things you know you should not have done. Or the things you left undone. The things the Lord laid on your heart to do, but you fought the Lord because you weren't ready to do them. I want you to confess. You got about 10 more seconds to confess your sins to the Lord. Feelings about folks that you don't know nothing about, but just what somebody else told you about them. Insecurities you have about yourself that God wants to heal you from it, but you ain't ready to let go of it. Let's share now in general confession. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men and women, we acknowledge and bewail our manifold sins and weakness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed by thought, word, and deed against your divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We'd earnestly repent, heartily sorry for these our misdoings. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us. Have mercy upon us. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past. And grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please thee in the newness of life. To the honor and the glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord, let the church say amen. Won't you face the outside walls and put your hands in the cross and allow us to place the bread and place the blood of our Lord and our Savior Jesus Christ in your hand. And then stewardess are here in the center aisle, be glad to receive your cup. Don't wait to get the bread and the wine together. Take the bread, eat it. Get the wine, drink it. And then go back to your seat. Down.
The cross where my Savior died.
cleansing from sin I cry. Dead to my heart was the blood of life. Glory to his name. Oh, I'm singing glory to his name. Precious name. In heaven,
hallowed it be. Thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done in earth as it is in heaven. This day, our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors, and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory.
Standing on your feet, let's reaffirm what we believe in. We call it the Apostles' Creed. Let's share it together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. Third day he rose from the dead, ascended to heaven, and sitteth on the right hand of God, the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Church universal, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of body, and life everlasting. Amen. Can we put our hands together and praise God for the band? Praise God for the praise team, sound ministry, our ushers, our greeters. Praise God for those who worshiping virtually. Praise God for our streaming ministry. Praise God for the PowerPoint ministry. Praise God for our children's church. Come on, and our servants. Come on, let's praise God for them and all of our guests. My brothers and sisters, don't forget, Tuesday we're flooding timelines on social media, Facebook, Twitter, and the gram with our LOL flyer, trying to encourage as many people to share with us in a time of giving. This Tuesday is Give Tuesday. We want to flood with the LOL flyer. If you can just do that for me at least 4 or 5 times on Tuesday, I would surely appreciate it. I believe somebody else wants to sow into the lives of needy children. Somebody ought to say amen. Won't you turn to your neighbor real quick and say, neighbor, walk with God. God will walk with you. Talk to God, and God will talk to you. Listen to God, and God will listen to you. Point to him and say, love God, because God first loved you. Won't you put both of your hands in the air? Grace, mercy, and peace. From God the Father, from God the Son, who sits at the right hand of God the Father, interceding on our behalf. From God the Holy Spirit, who rests, reigns, and rules inside of each and every one of us. Because thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. And let the church say amen. Have a blessed week in the Lord. Have a blessed week in the Lord. Don't forget your daily devotions. Please pick them on your way going up out the door.